Everybody, and welcome to St. James's Church, Piccadilly. This is the latest in our set of debates that we do in partnership with JustShare. And if you want to know any more about JustShare or indeed St. James's Piccadilly, do pick up the information that's available afterwards. There is a drink afterwards, which I think is being served at the back of the church there to your right, over your right shoulder, as it were. So do, at the end of it, stay for a drink and meet our speakers and continue the conversation. Tonight, we're debating women as agents of change. The confirmation of Hillary Clinton as the first woman to be nominated by a major US party to run for the role of president has once again turned our attention to the role that women play as agents of change across the globe. We have three distinguished speakers with us this evening, all of whom have a vast wealth of experience to share with us. And what will happen is that I'll ask each of the speakers to speak on their own subject, one after the other, and then we'll have a short panel discussion on picking up the points that each of the speakers have made. And then there's plenty of time for you to make your own points, contribution, to deepen our collective wisdom on this subject. So do please, as the speakers are speaking, think of things that you would like to ask or comments that you would like to make, as we do have plenty of time for that before we finish. And then right at the end, as I mentioned, at about 7:30, we'll invite you to stay for a drink and something to eat. So I would like to introduce our first speaker today, Christina Rees, CBE. Christina was for many years the leading activist for women's ordination in the Church of England. And perhaps it's appropriate for me to say, Christina, without you, people like me wouldn't have been ordained. So I want to say a personal thank you to you this evening. She was on the General Synod for 25 years, that's extraordinary, and was a founder member of the Archbishop's Council, the body that advises the Archbishops of Canterbury and York on matters of policy and resources. Christina's a well-known writer and broadcaster, and she speaks and preaches widely in the UK and in the US. Her books include The Divine Embrace and Voices of This Calling, Experiences of the First Generation of Women Priests. She was awarded a CBE in 2015 for services to the Church of England. Please would you welcome Christina Rees.
Thank you, Lucy, and thank you, Emily, from JustShare for inviting me to take part in this exciting evening discussing women as agents of change. If she can't satisfy her husband, what makes her think she can satisfy the country? In those few words, Donald Trump reduced Hillary Clinton to a sex object, a failed sex object, and placed on her the blame for her husband Bill Clinton's infidelities. In an interview on Radio 4 this morning, Nick Robinson asked Theresa May what made her angry. Her answer was injustice. She mentioned child abuse and modern-day slavery as two examples of injustice. I was hoping she would also mention discrimination against women. Many of the things that make the world unfair are inextricably linked to discrimination and prejudice against women. If flawed attitudes and beliefs about women and the resulting ways that women are treated were to be changed, it would transform the world. As Archbishop Desmond Tutu has said, ending sexism and including women fully in every aspect of society not only ends its own great evil, the oppression of women, but also is part of the solution to the rest of the world's problems. As Lucia said, I was for many years involved in the campaign for women to be allowed to be priests and bishops. And I've been asked to talk mainly about my experience there and the battle that went on went on before we had women bishops for nearly 100 years, and talk about what some of that can teach us about women's equality across the world and in other contexts. There is so much I could say about that. I've already written a lot about it, but it's a huge, huge subject, even though it's a small institution, relatively speaking, the Church of England. But I have four things I'd like to say that I learned from my experience that I think are relevant to this discussion tonight. First of all, theology matters. What we believe about ourselves, other people, the rest of creation, and God matters. And throughout the campaigning years, opponents would give what they called theological reasons why women either couldn't, namely, ordination doesn't take on women, some people said, or why women shouldn't. Women must remain in submission to men and under men's authority. Why they couldn't or shouldn't be ordained. And we realized pretty early on that the theology used was often a guise for justifying customs and traditions that discriminated against women. Often it came down to, it just wouldn't feel right to have a woman at the altar. It hasn't been done before, or we just don't want to change. Sometimes it was used as a veneer to cover sexism, and at times, and I'm glad to say, not that frequently, just raw misogyny. And I'd like to start, pause and say at this moment that men are not the enemy. They never were, they aren't now. The enemy are unjust systems that perpetuate the oppression of women. I would say patriarchy is the main culprit. There are others, but just to say that there is no room for a Christian to demonize half the human race. We realized that we had to present a different kind of vision, a more holistic and relational theology, to show what we believed about God and about who we are as people, men and women together, and what life was meant to be. The battle for gender justice is not like a tug of war with one small piece of rope that if it gets pulled in one direction, some people have more, and the people on the other side have less, and they lose. What we saw we needed to develop was moving from a belief in scarceness and limitation to a theology of abundance. Then people can be helped to let go of their resistance to making things better for women. There is enough for all. Justice and abundance are for everyone. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, if one of us suffers, we all suffer. If one of us is honored, we all rejoice. I believe he was describing our reality at a profound level, but do we believe that? Whatever the context, it's imperative to understand what people believe about women and men because their beliefs will be affecting their thinking and behavior, even if the context has nothing overtly to do with religion. The second thing that I learned was that language matters. For instance, many Christians say that, of course, God is beyond sex and gender and incorporates masculinity and femininity, but they behave as if God really is predominantly masculine or that God somehow relates more deeply to men. There was, and in some churches still is, a strong reaction to the introduction of more inclusive liturgies, especially inclusive images of God. If we cannot see women along with men, all of humanity, as made in the divine image, and see the feminine in God and God in the feminine, then it is unlikely we will ever be willing to bestow equal value on women. Centuries ago, the cutting-edge theologians of the day variously described women as the devil's gateway, as temples over sewers, as misbegotten males, sacks of manure, and opined that every woman should be ashamed that she was a woman. Comments made to some of the first ordained women were hardly better. They were called witches, unnatural women. And some men say they'd rather ordain a pork pie. If you deconstruct those kinds of comments, what is revealed is a debased view of women. Language, we know, shapes thought. During the campaign, we learned to use language very carefully, not only to be clear about what we were trying to communicate about women's ordination, but also about what we were saying more widely about how women should be treated in the church and in society, how there was a malaise at the heart of society, as the late Monica Furlong put it, a malaise that needs to be diagnosed, denounced, and demolished. My third point of learning that came out of those years of campaigning is, for real change to happen, winning people's hearts and minds is not enough. I'd like to be able to say that when we had largely won the intellectual and theological arguments about opening the priesthood to women, that it was plain sailing then to go on and have it possible to pass the legislation for women as bishops. It wasn't. The vote for women priests was in 1992. The legislation for women bishops was passed 20 years later. If a large majority of people agreed theologically about ordaining women as priests, accepting it was the right thing to do, then why did it take another two decades before General Synod passed the women bishops measure? I'd like to say that once we'd won the emotional arguments that the barriers to women's ordination just came tumbling down, like sort of, how would you feel if your daughter felt called to be ordained and she could not test that calling? But if your son felt called, he could test it. And like, oh, well, of course, women will make wonderful priests. They'll be so good. They'll bring a new richness and depth to ministry and reach out to people who haven't been reached before. All those arguments, but those were not enough. We observed that some people who said they were in favor didn't follow through in their voting patterns or in how they talked about it, and in some instances, in how they behaved. I came to realize that there is a third, more primal place in us that needs to be converted if change is to happen, and that is the gut. You can't reason with the gut. We instinctively either trust someone or not, or we feel uncertain about something and can't explain why. We just know we do. And there was an extraordinary example that took place on the floor of Synod during one debate on women's ordination. And a male priest got up and he started off, he was very composed, and he said, I'm so in favor, this is absolutely the right thing to do. We've waited a long time, we've gone through all the arguments, let's go forward. And then it was as if he shifted gear a little bit and he said, but some of my friends, they will be destroyed. Their understanding of what the church is, they will feel the church has abandoned them and they will have to leave. They won't know, they won't have the church anymore as a home. And he got more and more emotionally involved. And then he shifted gear a third time and he became incredibly, almost incoherent, and he started to cry. And he went red in the face and said, how can we do this? How dare the church ask us to do this? And completely, by the end of his speech, he was almost crumpled in his place. And he had gone completely on the opposite of where he'd started. Head, heart, gut. When it came to the vote, you probably don't need me to tell you how he voted. The fourth point I want to make is you need to find out who has the power and then understand how and why they're using it the way they do. The Church of England has moved on from debating women's ordination, not that everything is fine for women in the Church of England, but that the ordination debates are over. Women are now legally permitted to be appointed to any role in the Church of England, even Archbishop. And it's currently debating sexuality, particularly same-sex relationships. While the issues we were fighting for with women's ordination were different, the dynamics are similar, and in both cases, they reveal a dynamics of exclusion. When women were being actively kept out, someone or something was keeping them out. We learned it was important to notice who controls the agenda, who defines the terms of reference, who decides who gets invited to the table. The campaign took so long because time and time again, those setting the agenda and framing the draft legislation were starting from the wrong place with the wrong assumptions. It became clear that many of the ways in which the synod worked and some of the individuals holding key posts within the church were not supportive or just didn't get it. Whatever the context, it is vital to figure out who is controlling the agenda, who is defining the orthodoxy, and in whose interests is it. Tragic and mistaken as those may be, to perpetuate unjust systems for women that keep women oppressed and excluded, down and out. That's necessary in order to make lasting change. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Katie Allen. Katie is Policy and Programme Grants Manager at Women for Women International UK, which is a charity that supports women in conflict-affected countries to rebuild their and their families' lives. Katie manages projects across 7 countries that support the most marginalised women to earn and save money, improve health and well-being, influence decisions in their home and community, and connect to networks for support. Katie has 8 years' experience working on international development and conflict recovery programmes. Please welcome Katie Allen.
Thank you very much for the introduction and for inviting me to be part of this event tonight. So as Lucy mentioned, I look after our funding from European donors that go to directly to some of the most marginalized women in conflict-affected countries. And I've spent particular time this year working on projects in the Democratic Republic of Congo and Nigeria. So I wanted to start by just giving a couple of examples of ways in which women that I met when I visited those countries are working to create change in their communities. So in the Democratic Republic of Congo, I met a group of women who have come together to try and improve the access to land. For them, they're very dependent on agriculture, and so land is a very important asset and issue for them. And the national laws do permit women to own and inherit land, but in reality, at the local level, the customs and the laws in place there don't. So the women are going around telling other women in their community, men and their traditional leaders, about the national level laws and trying to say, you know, actually we should be able to access land. And they're trying to create change at that level. In Nigeria, I met some women who were talking about how they're really sick of the levels of drug abuse in their community. For them, this was a really important issue. It was affecting their children and their families. So they organized a massive demonstration. They got together loads of women, and it had the result of actually making the drug dealers that were there flee because they were so scared of being reported to the police. So I just thought these were really inspiring examples, and I do come across examples like this all the time that really motivate me. But that's not to say that it's easy, and it's not to say that all women are able to take these kind of actions. So I'll just talk a little bit about the kind of challenges that the women we work with face being in conflict-affected countries, and then about what we do and what they kind of can do as a result. So, obviously, there's a lot of reasons why women that have been through conflict might be quite traumatized by that. One of the biggest ones that we deal with is women having been subject to sexual violence. So this is something in a lot of the countries we work in: Congo, Rwanda, South Sudan, Bosnia, and now most recently in Iraq with the Yazidi women that we're working with who have fled from ISIS. This is obviously very dehumanizing and traumatizing for women. Another issue we face a lot is restricted freedom of movement. So this might be due to insecurity, or it might be because of cultural traditions that don't let women go out much, like in Afghanistan, where women are barely able to leave their houses in some communities. And then in slight contrast to that, there's the fact that a lot of women will have experienced displacement, and whether that's, you know, perhaps multiple times and means that they've lost their networks and people they used to know. And there's a lot of evidence to show that there's a high correlation between levels of conflict and gender inequality. So this is something that we certainly experience, and it means that the women we're working with are often dealing with other kinds of cultural traditions that are working against them, whether that might be early enforced marriage, practices like female genital mutilation. Boys will have been prioritized for access to school. And the other thing, of course, is that now men might have been killed in conflict, and the women could be left as the sole breadwinners, as it were, for their families, but they haven't previously been given the kind of skills and experience to manage that. So these are some of the reasons why we work with women in these environments. And that's always been at the root of what we've done. So Women for Women was founded over 20 years ago by quite an inspirational lady herself called Zainab Salbi. She was from Iraq, and her father was actually a pilot for Saddam Hussein. And eventually it just got too dangerous for her family, and she was sent to America to marry a stranger over there. She was very young at that time, and then she went to university in America. And she started to learn about 20th century history and was learning about World War II. And at the same time, it was when the conflict in Bosnia was unfolding, and she was watching it on the news, and she was like, we said never again, how is this being able to happen now? And she was really moved to act, so she flew out to Bosnia, and she met with women that had been in the rape camps there. And she started just asking them what they needed and talking to them about what they'd been through. And that was the foundation of what we did. She connected women in Bosnia to women in other parts of the world through letter exchange for moral support, and then also with direct financial support. And this has kind of grown over the years as women have said, well, actually, we now have to provide for our families, so can you give us some skills to earn an income, or we need to know about the laws of our country and how to work in a democracy, so can you tell us more about that? And it's developed into a year-long training education program, which covers all areas of women's lives. So this is helping them earn an income, learning about their rights and how to become decision makers in their communities. Access to networks is really important as well, and also health, key health issues and well-being. And I think that the educational components of what we provide is really important, because you can just see how, as soon as women that previously have had no education learn about the laws and the information that they can refer to, whether this might be around their access to land or around something like family planning, that they immediately roll with it and want to put that into action. It's really incredible. But I also think there's a little bit more on top of this, maybe a kind of magic touch, as I see it, for what we do, that's on top of the education. And this is more around the kind of solidarity and relationship aspects. So it's the open space that women are given to talk about their experiences with others who have been through the same. It's friendships they build with other women going through training with them. It's the boost they get from putting their new skills into practice and having others in the community look up to them. And it's also the boost they get when they receive a letter from their sponsor, who is someone in a whole other part of the world but that's thinking about them, because we've maintained this kind of letter exchange component. So rather take an example from somewhere else, a lady I also respect very much, a Buddhist teacher called Tara Brach, said that we empower people when we help them reconnect with the truth of who they are. And I think this is the kind of power that we're trying to unleash in women, helping them realize their own potential. And it certainly seems to work. Our data seems to show that women can thrive when they're given access to this kind of education and skills. On average, after training, women triple their income. The vast majority share what they're learning with other women in their communities. More than twice as many at the end of training say they've stopped a harmful traditional practice against them and that they've run for leadership positions. And it's also often said that women, if they're earning an income and have new skills, will reinvest that into their families. And this is something we find as well. 20% of women that we work with report that they do use their stipend towards school fees. So just to kind of wrap up a little bit, I think that at the grassroots level, women do have to be the ones driving the fight for gender equality. But it's really important that they're supported by laws and the enforcement of those laws as a kind of framework for them. And it's also really important that they can tackle the social norms that are in their community. And this means they absolutely have to work with men and work with men as allies, explaining to them as well the benefits of women's empowerment and the benefits for the whole community. And so what are these benefits? There's many, of course. In my opinion, a couple to highlight would be that the economic participation of women, there's lots of evidence to show that this raises hugely household income and encourages economic development of countries as a whole. And then also, as I mentioned before, although it's not clear whether gender equality leads to peace or peace leads to gender equality, there's clearly a correlation between these things. So I feel that anything we can do to contribute to gender equality will hopefully help us have more peaceful and prosperous societies as well. So I will leave it there for now. Thank you.
Our third speaker is Anneke van Woudenberg. Anneke is the Executive Director of Rights and Accountability in Development, RAID, an NGO which holds companies to account for their human rights abuses. Since 1999, she's focused on humanitarian and human rights issues in the Great Lakes region of Africa, working as the Congo Country Director for Oxfam GB during the height of the war. In 2014, she took on the role as Advocacy Director for Human Rights Watch's Africa Division. She's provided regular briefings on the situation in Congo to the United Nations Security Council, the US Congress, the British Parliament, and the European Parliament. Please welcome Anneke van Woudenberg.
Thank you, Lucy. Thank you, everyone, for coming to talk about this issue at a time when I think it's perhaps more important than it has been in quite some time. Women's rights are human rights. I'm going to repeat that. Women's rights are human rights. I'm not sure who coined the phrase, but it was used to great effect and popularized by Hillary Clinton. For those who may remember, this was in 1995 when Hillary Clinton was First Lady and she spoke at the Fourth World Conference for Women in Beijing. And it's this foundation that I take this evening, and it's one that many of us who work in the human rights world passionately believe in, that women's rights are human rights. I'm by nature an optimist, and I think there is still an awful lot for us to celebrate in terms of advancement for women's rights across the world, particularly in Western countries, but there have been noticeable improvements in many other parts of the world too. But I'm also deeply troubled. Let me lay out what I think are some of the challenges we face today in terms of respect for human rights and therefore women's rights. And I want to do this because I think it has a huge bearing on the situation of women and girls across the world. And the picture, I have to say, is rather bleak. Let me start with listing out what I think some of these challenges are today. Firstly, I think that norms and values of the human rights movement are under sustained assault. And this really began after 9/11 by the policies pursued by the United States under George W. Bush, where torture was in effect legalized, but it has continued since then. And for those of us who work in the human rights movement, we've seen this assault continue year on year. Respect for human rights and the laws of war are routinely flouted by parties to the conflict, whether that be in Syria, in Yemen, in Iraq, or in South Sudan, just to name a few. Very rarely are there any consequences. I'm not sure I would have believed 10 years ago that we would have seen the use of chemical weapons, as we're seeing in Syria, without there being a very clear and direct consequence for any state party who did so. Yet that is precisely what we've seen. Doors are closing to refugees around the world. The Refugee Convention, the laws which are set in stone in terms of respect for refugees, is under significant attack. And there's more displacement in the world today than at any point in time since World War II. In Western countries, including our own, xenophobic speech is on the rise and it has returned to public debate. There's a growing sense of insecurity and growing inequality, even though the world is richer today than it has been at any point in time in its history. And we see this, whether that is by the discourse of Donald Trump, the discourse in this country in lead up to the referendum on the EU, or even in our own London elections, which happened just recently, the dog whistle politics, the use of xenophobic innuendo and speech is on the rise. Governments on cracking down are becoming much more assertive towards civil society, especially civil society that focuses on government accountability. We've seen that in places like Turkey. I myself have been personally involved in some of that in places like Kenya, but frankly also in the United States, where Human Rights Watch was one of the organizations that the US government was trawling information on through the subversive attempts to collect information illegally. And mainstream news outlets, who used to pride themselves on factual impartial reporting, are struggling in the new digitalized age. Social media is a difficult and double-edged sword, and we are seeing new kinds of news outlets become increasingly unfactual, if that's a word I can use, or have extremely strong political colors, like Fox News, for instance, in the United States. All of these challenges are being played out before our very eyes, of course, in the US election at the moment, where I think we're seeing a type of language being used by a front runner, the Republican candidate, Donald Trump for president, in a way that I think none of us might have imagined months or even years ago. This is not only deeply troubling, but it is also giving credence to this kind of views, to these what I would term as racist xenophobic views. So what are the challenges facing women? I would say all of those affect women and girls around the world. But of course, there are some specific things that all of us face. Again, I just want to lay out a few of those just to help us with our debate and our discussion. Forgive me if some of these are generalized, because undoubtedly there are some issues that are unique to women in the developing world, which women in the developed world don't face as much of. There are, of course, also issues that we all face across the board. Again, I'm afraid, a bit of a list. Let me go through those and I'll expand a bit more on a few of them. The one that still hits me in the gut every single time is violence against women. And this is one of those particular issues that women face across the world, regardless of age, income, or education. One in three women globally will face some degree of violence during their lifetime. A significant proportion of that violence is in an intimate setting at home. And I want to talk a little bit more about that because I think it's a really important issue for us to look at in terms of gender equity. I'm going to quickly go through just a few of the others because I think they're also important to note. Child marriage. 720 million women in the world today were married before the age of 18, with significant knock-on consequences for their children, for their education levels, and for advancement economically in their society. Trafficking of women, particularly into labor and slavery, continues. 21 million people are trafficked worldwide. 55% of those are women or girls. Women and girls continue to be refused access to education, as Katie alluded to. Death in childbirth or during pregnancy remains needlessly high across the world. And, as we all know, significant underrepresentation politically for women and girls. Again, this is across the world. I want to pause on this one for a moment because the statistics are telling here. There are today 21 female heads of state out of 315. That includes the Queen of this country and the Queen of Denmark. 21. Women are significantly lower in numbers, not just politically, but on boards in businesses. Women still remain underrepresented in most major religions, the Church of England included. And again, this is something that is across the world where progress has been remarkably and shockingly slow. I mean, we knew this 20, 30, 40 years ago, and yet there has been such small increases across the board on this issue. Women continue to be paid less for work. Again, this is a global trend. Around the world, women earn 24% less than men, globally. It's 30% if you're in Africa. Yet women work harder, especially if you take into account paid and unpaid work together. In nearly all countries, women work longer hours than men. I think in this country, if I'm not mistaken, it's 35 minutes on a daily basis that women work more than men if you take paid and unpaid work into account. And we're also prevented from making deeply personal choices. Again, this played out on our newspapers, in the headlines this summer for us. I want to just mention two cases. A woman in Sudan flogged for wearing jeans, and a woman on a beach in France, targeted because she was wearing a burkini. These are deeply personal choices about what we wear and how we wear it that continues to be restricted or legislated by men. I want to go back to this issue for a moment of violence against women, because I think this is such an important one. How women are perceived in the home, how women are treated in the home, directly correlates to how women are treated in society. The church is part of that, if we look at broader society, but that very private space is a very important way in which you can see how a society will treat its women. I have a lot of experience in the Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm glad Katie mentioned it as well. And for me, that was where I really saw the issue of violence against women hit home, both on a positive and on a negative basis. Congo is probably one of the worst places in the world to be a woman or a girl. It's often called the rape capital of the world, a terrible kind of label that I think most people in Congo would love to get rid of, but it talks about a particular reality that the women and girls there face. Tens of thousands, probably hundreds of thousands of women have been raped in Congo between 1998 and 2016. We don't know the numbers precisely, because it's really hard to collect statistics in a war zone. Yet we do know that most of the women raped were gang raped, usually by anywhere between 5 to 7 assailants. We know that most of the rape was extremely violent. How do we know that? Because tens of thousands of women have had to seek medical treatment. We know in one particular year, because an academic study was done by it, that 400,000 women and girls were raped in one particular year in the middle of the war. Extrapolate that to other years, and we can assume millions of women and girls were raped. When I first started in Congo over 14 years ago, women and girls didn't talk about it. It was a shameful thing. It was something you didn't want to talk about because chances were your husband was going to extradite you from the house or ask you to leave because you'd put shame on the family or the community. But when a certain scale is reached, you can't not talk about it. When the rape is public or publicly done to you in front of your family or in the town square, you can't not talk about it. And so women began to talk about it. They began to get together. They began to provide each other with support, economic support, a listening ear, a shoulder to cry on. And out of this terrible scourge that has affected that society in such a horrible way has come a women's movement, has come an uprising of women who say, yes, we're going to talk about it. We're going to urge our government to stop, and we're going to run for political office. They haven't yet been terribly successful at that, but I'm seeing more and more organization, more and more support and increases in women's groups than I saw 14 years ago. And I think this issue of violence is one that often brings women together. Again, because as I said, the statistics are so global, and because how women are viewed in the home is so directly connected to that. You know, I remember speaking to a number of Congolese women, and it's something that those of us who work in Congo talk about endlessly. Why is it so bad? Why is it that this particular place in the world has this on such a large scale? And one thing that Congolese women always said to me, hard to put a number or figure onto, but they said, we were second-class citizens before the war. There was huge amounts of domestic abuse, they said, and they believed that that had a direct correlation on how things were played out when society fell apart and when the rule of law was no longer operating. I mention this because I think some of what we're hearing, again, back to Donald Trump, about views of women, about the role of women, is therefore so important because of this correlation between how women are viewed at home and violence against women and equality against women in society. What should be done? Many things. But I'm going to also mention one that, in fact, both Katie and Christina mentioned, one that I think is critical. Change laws, enforce the changes in those laws, follow through. And again, we see so often that a law might be changed, but there's no follow through or no implementation of that law. When we see positive examples, we immediately see impact on the ground. And I'm going to end on this one example because for me, this hit home so hard when it happened last year. The International Criminal Court is one of the few courts around the globe that has larger numbers of female judges than male, 56% in the case of the International Criminal Court. It also has a prosecutor, a chief prosecutor, who is a woman. Earlier this year, a Congolese vice president, known as Jean-Pierre Bemba, his trial came to conclusion at the International Criminal Court. He'd been charged with a wide variety of war crimes and crimes against humanity, one of which was sexual violence. Jean-Pierre Bemba hadn't raped himself. He had commanded troops who used widespread sexual violence both in the Democratic Republic of Congo and in the Central African Republic. He didn't do it. He wasn't on the ground. He was commanding through a telephone and through different kinds of orders. The judges sitting on his case were three women, an East European, an African, and an Asian woman. And when they came down with their judgment, it was blistering. And you saw in the courtroom this man who had been an extraordinarily big man in Africa diminish, diminish, diminish as the judgment or a summary of the judgment was read out by the Chief Justice of that bench of three judges. And they said very clearly, what you did was wrong. Not only was it wrong, it was illegal. It constituted a war crime and a crime against humanity. And just because you didn't do it yourself doesn't absolve you of responsibility. You created an environment where this happened, you permitted it to happen, you knew it happened, and you did nothing. He got 17 years in prison, but I talked to a woman activist in the Central African Republic the day after that judgment came out. She had watched it unfold herself. She had seen it on her computer screen. And she said, that was the day I knew things were beginning to change, because three women sat in judgment on this particular man and said to him, this is not okay and this is illegal. And all they were doing was applying the law. But we need more application, robust application of some of those laws, and we need to work to change them when they're unjust or when they're wrong. Thank you.
Very much to our three speakers, and I'll just have a short discussion on the panel here, and then there's some time for you to be able to contribute, and we have a roving microphone there, so do be thinking about that. One thing I just want to pick up with any of our speakers who'd like to comment is that there was quite an emphasis in some of your presentations on the law. So laws need to be changed, follow through, I think you said, Anneke. But there was also quite a lot of discussion about culture, which is about the hearts and minds and guts. Perhaps I can start with Christina. What do you think is the balance between getting laws changed and changing the hearts and minds and the language and the more perhaps soft aspects of how we're being spoken about that will lead to really being agents, not just recipients of change, agents of change?
Well, I think obviously they work together, and that's usually the way we see it. But I think that a huge amount of work has to go in ahead of a law being changed, because before a law is changed, first of all, you have to get someone prepared to draft it. You have to bring a drafting committee, possibly a revision committee. It takes a very long time to create rules, and all during that time, it could go askew and awry and turn out to be very bad rules, depending on the clauses that are drafted. Unless the attitudes have already changed. So I would say it's really entrenched views about women, entrenched inequality, again being played out in front of us in terms of the presidential debate in the United States, where we're seeing kind of Donald Trump's use of language matters, in terms of his comments on women, in terms of how women look, in terms of the role of women. I mean, that I would have thought we had changed those attitudes already, or at least not for it to be acceptable in a presidential debate. And yet we haven't. We kind of roll back on that. So, I mean, obviously it's across the board. I think it's attitudes, it's laws, it's enforcement of the laws, and then it's also publicizing the enforcement of the laws. I think that I certainly see internationally is so important, and it's why I mentioned the case of the International Criminal Court, because the more that that is publicized, the more it has ramifications in those societies most affected.
And I want to pick up the issue of leadership. I mean, obviously, two of you mentioned Trump, Clinton. There's a big conversation going on, which the whole world is kind of listening into, and it's revealing, it's revealing attitudes, not just in the US, but I mean, as you've both mentioned, globally. But Katie, can I just pick that up with you? How important is it that women are in leadership positions? So they're in decision-making positions. I mean, obviously, Hillary Clinton's going for one of the top jobs in the world, but in your experience, how important is it for women to be in those decision-making layers of institutions?
I think it's definitely important. I think for a range of reasons. Partly it is that having those role models, I think, is really important for women at every level, so that they can see that is possible. And then in terms of the decisions that then can get made, there's so many issues because communities where I visit and where we work, the leadership structures are almost entirely male currently. And so there's just so many issues that just don't even cross the table of consideration.
Can you give us one example?
You mentioned about pregnancy and issues around women's healthcare and the rate of kind of maternal mortality. There's a lot of issues around that, family planning as well, that just wouldn't be considered as an issue that the men would kind of discuss and have and try to take action on in the community. But when women start to get involved in some of those decision-making forums where they can and they raise those issues, then it starts to enable change to happen for the whole community. So yeah, I think it's very
important. I'm really interested in this issue about, we're all saying that change needs to happen, but we're also talking about women as sometimes being, as I said, the recipients of change. Women are done too, but we're talking about women as agents. How can women make the changes that are good for women and for men? So let's take some comments from the audience then. Yes, just at the front here. Simon will bring a microphone. Can I ask you to be brief and to ask a question as briefly as you can?
So it's actually just...
It's okay.
...in relation to the mention of algorithmic networks, so in the variable countries. And I was wondering what your opinions were on the importance of bringing digital age to women in relation to making them agents of change.
Thank you very much. And let's take another comment or two. We'll pick that up. Thank you. Yes, just halfway back there.
I want to focus on the word austerity. You mentioned that one of the key lessons you learned was the importance of changing that narrative. There is an abundance of justice. There is justice for all. What is the impact that the austerity policies across Europe are having unequally on women, and how do we as women
thank you very much. And is that, yes, just at the front here.
One of the things that's been mentioned so many times this evening already is the Donald Trump US presidential race. Yeah, it's horrible. So right now, the polls are showing that they're practically neck and neck. Hillary is slightly ahead. But the Americans are allowed free speech.
Thank you. Thank you. And we'll take one more, just, yes, halfway back on this side. Okay, so we've got a fantastic range there. We've got how important is the digital age in the empowerment of women? I'm going to come to you, Katie, about that first. We've got a question about austerity and abundance, the impact of austerity policies on women. Perhaps I can ask Anneke to address that. Head, heart and gut was specifically for Christina, and let's all have a go at Trump. So, shall we just go to the digital age? Katie, can you say a bit about how important is that?
Yeah, I think that is increasingly important. There's lots of different ways that it could be very valuable for women, obviously from the kind of inclusion, financial inclusion aspect. People can use digital technology and phones for accessing finance, and that's something that we've tried to do. And then there's just the information that is accessible and the connections that are accessible through digital networks that have massive potential to empower women in some of the more kind of remote parts of the world. So I think trying to find ways to increase accessibility to digital resources is a really kind of, could be a quite concrete and useful way to help encourage epidemic.
And in your experience, is that happening? When you said it could be, it would be great if, yeah, is it actually happening?
It's in the places where we were, not so much, because I just think there's still such a long way to go, and kind of access to those kind of technologies is still a bit behind. I mean, there are in some of the places we work, to be fair, as I said, like in Nigeria, they have quite good access to mobile phones. So I think it's definitely an area still for development.
Anneke, austerity policies, what's the impact on women?
Tricky. Look, one thing that I think is so stark at the moment is something I mentioned, where we have we're the richest we've ever been, and the discrepancy between the world's richest and the world's poorest is bigger. That gap is bigger than it's ever been. My sense is, and I don't have enough data to back this up, though perhaps in the audience there's someone who does, that gap, of course, affects women and girls more than anyone else. But what I do think it is contributing to is this sense of insecurity and this sense of uncertainty. And when people are insecure and they're uncertain, they scapegoat. And then we scapegoat minorities, we scapegoat women, we become more xenophobic. I do think those things are directly related. And I'm deeply troubled about where that's taking us. And I think that is a concern a little bit about Trump. Yeah. Do I get to go into him already?
Go quickly on Trump.
Because I think Trump is hitting on something that clearly quite a number of people agree with. And I think it is that sense of people are butting in line ahead of me, or all my woes are because of this person or that person or this person or that person, and the scapegoating. And I think we have to recognize that there are people in the world feeling deeply insecure for whom that resonates. And I think this kind of gap between rich and poor is part of that problem. How we counter that, I have some thoughts on, but
okay, we'll come back
to that. Just
come
yet.
Back. Gut, Christina. Mm-hmm. How do you do that? Change that? Is it possible?
One quick word about the austerity abundance before I go on to the gut. The former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, gave a talk last week, really about who is my neighbour, and he used the parable of the Good Samaritan to talk about being open to the other and saying, if you can't see yourself in the other and the other in you, then there's no hope. There is an artificial understanding of who we are, because we are not separate. We are all in this together. And I would say that there is obviously many places in the world where there is genuine austerity. And the abundance I was talking about is an abundance that, first of all, we know that there is enough food and water, etc., in the world for everyone, but it's not getting to everyone. But the abundance I was
talking about is an attitude of seeing the other as that, seeing yourself in the other and seeing the other in yourself. And with that attitude, then you don't get policies that distort our reality of all being together. And so part of abundance is seeing the reality that that there is not this separation, there is no other in a sense. And if we could only see that there is no other genuinely, that would help, and it would help the women's issue as well, but it would also help with this gut. I think changing the gut is incredibly hard. I think guts almost need conversion, divine intervention, a bolt from heaven. And that does sometimes happen. I also think it comes with experience. And I'm sure Lucy could tell many, many examples of people coming in or encountering her, particularly when you were in St. Paul's, where there was this gut reaction to seeing her at the altar with a clerical collar and robes on, but Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and all of a sudden, Lucy starts looking like normal. It's okay, I feel safe, I'm not frightened. Lucy starts
looking
like
one of my combinations. Ah.
But I mean, I think a word I didn't use is the word fear. And I would put fear as one of the main problems that we faced for the entire 25 years plus. Just incredible fear and projecting all sorts of things onto women and the fear of change. And I think gut has a fear, it holds fear there. But it can be transformed. It takes time. It might take just some sort of shocking conversion. It usually just takes experience.
And just very briefly, do we have any kind of constructive, positive things to say about this Trumpy discourse, if we can call it like that? We live in a Trumpy world, the director of Chatham House said last week. He put Trump and Brexit together. But do you have any sense of how we can counter that, how we can tell a different story? Anneke first.
Well, I suppose from my perspective, I don't think silence is an option. I think it is important to speak out. I think it is important for voices to be heard loudly and clearly, countering what Trump is saying, and doing the opposite of this kind of small-minded, xenophobic type of view that he has. My background is human rights, and one of the key things that human rights people are always saying is you've got to be part of the discourse, you've got to be part of the voices being heard. Silence is not an option, and I guess that's what I would say, is I think we have to, even though we don't, those of us who live here don't get a chance to vote, may not be able to have that kind of a voice, but still saying we don't agree, because what Trump is saying is not just for a US audience. It is affecting all of us, partly because we're all watching it. Language matters, our language, in response to these kind of small-minded views matter, and we should not be silent.
Christina?
I was born in the States, and I hold dual citizenship, and I just cannot believe this is happening in my old country. But I think there's some sort of strange, invisible resonance between the Brexit vote and Trump. And the positive thing I would say is that in both instances, but particularly with what's going on in the States, is that Trump has tapped into a huge level of discontent, a huge level of mistrust in the government, in the establishment. People feeling that life isn't going well. The American dream seems to be dying a death or fading away. And somehow he has managed to galvanize people around the fact that he can do something about it. Well, everything he's saying, as far as I'm concerned, is completely against the principles and the tenets of why America was the founding fathers of America. I can't think of anything less in line with the founding fathers of America and all that went on there than what Donald Trump is preaching. But I think one of the things we can do is listen to why people are responding. What is he tapped into? And perhaps people can try to address the real issues behind it. Obviously, Trump does not have the solutions any of us would like. But if people are unhappy, and people are frightened, and people are not feeling secure, then something needs to happen about that. Trump is not the answer. But we need to ask ourselves, what is the answer, and what can we do about it?
So it is important to listen to that.
We have to listen to it. We have to listen to the Brexit vote.
Yep.
Why did that happen? It was a protest vote in some, you know, for some people it was genuine, but for some reason it was a protest vote against the establishment, against people who didn't seem to care what their lives were like. And, you know, that goes on long enough, and all of a sudden a person living with certain things in their lives will say, I've had enough of this, and will grasp at straws. And to grasp at Trump is to grasp at a very malign straw, and it's very frightening, but we have to listen to that.
I'm just going to take a couple more comments from the audience. We're running just very slightly over time. Yes, please, just there. Very much. Yes, just there. And then last, just at the front here.
The panel expressed a lot of hostility to Trump and to people who voted Brexit, and they don't seem to understand why. Our last speaker here pressured us or tried to persuade us to be more welcoming of movements, huge numbers of movements of people into our country. Well, 17 million people in this country voted Brexit because they've had this multiracial society imposed on them by the establishment. They were never asked, at no point were the British people ever asked in any general election since 1945, do you wish to have Britain converted into a multiracial society? It was imposed on them.
Is there a question?
And finally, the people through this referendum were given a chance to speak, and they did speak. Are you people going to wake up? That's my question.
Okay, thank you for your question. And then just the last comment here at the front. Yes, you. Thank you.
Imagine you get raped in England, in London, and the person who raped you will be brought all the way to Germany and has to stand trial in Germany. Do you think that is right? No, it is not. Apparently, Jean-Pierre Bemba was so bad and everything, but a lot of people in Congo actually like him because he has helped a lot of people. And why is it okay for a lot of African presidents to be judged somewhere else? Why cannot we just go back to where they come from and be judged there? Because in Congo, up to now, we have soldiers, children who didn't say, we used to work with Joseph Kabila. He used to send us. But why is America, human watching everyone not doing anything about Joseph Kabila? Because people have proof and we have witnesses who say that he is the one responsible for it. Why would you put someone who the whole country says it's not him, it's someone else?
Thank you. Do you want to pick up the Congo point particularly? And then I'm going to ask you for your closing remarks, please.
Well, I'm happy to pick up on both points, actually, if I might. Actually, my point about migration that I made, it was actually about refugees. And I think it's important for us to separate two things. There is obviously part of what's happening in Europe today is migration for economic reasons. Part of what's also happening are people fleeing conflict because they're being targeted and because they are facing persecution at home. The law on persecution and refugees is quite clear. And there, the UK has signed up to it, as are many other countries in the world, where people genuinely seeking flight from persecution should be granted asylum. Now, we have to separate out migration from refugees, but I think what I'm saying in terms of the challenges for us on human rights is that the Refugee Convention is being cut to shreds at the moment, and we should not allow that to happen. Those coming for migration reasons or for reasons of economic advantage, that's a different discussion. It's a different debate. But in terms of refugees, I think that that should be quite clear, and we should respect the conventions that the UK and other nations in Europe have signed to.
Thank you.
Well, it's not a question of numbers. I mean, I think that's a slightly separate debate, and I think it's important to separate those out.
You can carry that on afterwards. We're going to come to a close. Can you
move on to the Congo question. Look, the reality is that, I've worked in Congo for 14 years. There's been huge attempts to ask for justice domestically in Congo, as there are in many other countries in the world. It is precisely what should happen. Justice is best served when it is done in the communities most affected by people of those communities. I would agree that that is a much better way to go than to do it through the International Criminal Court. And in fact, the International Criminal Court is a court of last resort. In the case of the Congolese detainees before the International Criminal Court, it's actually the government of Congo who requested the International Criminal Court to start doing the investigations, hugely supported by civil society in Congo. But I agree, in an ideal world, we would be seeing justice locally in those communities, and that would be a much better way for change to take place.
I'm going to ask each of the panellists just to give us a very, very brief one thing that this audience can take away. How can we enable women to be agents of change, not just recipients of change? Katie first.
One thing, okay. In that case, I'll focus on the grassroots perspective, I guess, of how collective voice of women is really important. And although we've talked a lot about the laws and the social norms, that has to be complemented by women themselves driving change and asking for change and holding their leaders to account. So I think people here could be doing that here, and you could also be connecting with women in other parts of the world that need that support to help them also push for change in their communities.
Thank you. Christina? One thing to take away.
If you want to make a change in something, some area, spend a little time analysing the problem, what's wrong. Spend a lot of time describing the vision of the way it's going to be when things change.
Thank you, and Anneke.
Gosh, there isn't one thing, but I, as much as already been said this evening, I think I would say go into those uncharted territories where we don't see the perspective of women and girls being reflected today. And you know, one thing that continues to strike me is the lack of women involved in areas of research and the lack of research on women's issues. And so I think if we want public policy change, there does need to be more analysis of the issues on women, and I think there should be more women in research.
So any budding researchers out there, you heard it here first. Can I, on your behalf, thank, please, Christina Rees, Katie Allen, and Anneke van Woudenberg. Please stay for the interview.